Good morning, Prince of Peace Community Church and Healing Center. It is so good to see you this morning. Good morning to the pastor of this church, Reverend Dr. Jendiel K. Grady, and good morning to the First Lady of this church, Kelly Grady. Hello to all our members, family, and friends. I tell you, I couldn't wait for Sunday service. There's just so much going on in the world, so much going on within our families and our friends' lives that I can't wait for Sunday to come, because I need the praise. I need the worship. I need the prayers. I need the encouragement. And most of all, I need the word of God. I need to hear what God is speaking to us during these difficult times. What is it that God is saying to us to lift us, to encourage us, to help us to grow, even in the midst of all that we're going through? Many of us can truly say we are still growing in Christ. We are confident. We are encouraged. We are obtaining courage to open our mouths and speak the word of God. Amen. Amen. There are people that need to know who God is. And most of us, if not all of us, are in a position to open up our mouths and speak the word of God and let people know that God still lives. And then they ask, well, how do you know? We know because he lives within each of us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To God be the glory and to God be the praise. Let's have church. Levites, please take us higher in the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord, draw near to worship Christ the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring he is good. Come bless the Lord, come bless the Lord, draw near to worship Christ the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring he is good. Oh, that men would pray. Draw near to worship Christ the Lord, and bless his name, his holy name, declaring he is good. Oh, that men would praise him. Oh, that men would praise him. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, can I say, rejoice in the Lord.
Good morning, Prince of Peace. Our call to worship can be found in Psalm 95. Let us sing songs of praise. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as at Meribah, as on the day at Massah in the wilderness, when your fathers put me to the test and put me to the proof, though they had seen my work. For 40 years I loathed that generation and said, there are people who go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Therefore I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, reading, and adhering to of his word. Amen.
Good morning, saints, and welcome, everyone. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come this morning declaring that there is none like you, none like you in all the earth. For Lord God, your grace and your mercy exceeds anything we could ever hope for or imagine. So Father God, we come lifting up the name of Jesus, a name above all other names, a name, Lord God, like none other. We stand strong before you this morning, knowing that when we are weak, we are strong. Strong, Lord God, knowing that your grace is sufficient and that your power is made perfect in weakness. Father God, I thank you for the friends and visitors that have gathered together with us this morning to partake of this worship experience. I thank you, Lord God, because in this day of virtual worship, they could serve anywhere. But they chose to worship with the Prince of Peace family, Lord God, and for that I say thank you. I thank you, Father, for blessing them over the past week, Lord God, and I thank you for the blessings yet to come. I ask, Lord God, that you bless their homes, Lord God, that you remove anything that should not be, and that your glory rain down upon them. I ask, Lord God, that for those who have experienced the loss of loved ones, I ask, Lord God, that you hold them in the palm of your hand, giving them the strength needed during this period of bereavement. For those, Lord God, that are sick, I pray healing. And for the confused, Lord God, I pray your divine guidance. And Lord God, for those that feel like they are alone in this world, I ask, O Holy Spirit, I pray that you will rise up, letting them know that the Comforter is right there with them. Father God, I continue to pray for the people of Ukraine. I don't understand the killing of innocent men, women, and children for any reason, let alone to gain control of a country. But Father, what I don't understand, I'm so glad that you do. So Lord God, I continue to pray for an end to this war. I pray for protection and provision of those still in Ukraine and for those who are able to leave. Lord God, I pray for those on the battlefield fighting for their country. Father, I pray for the president of Ukraine and the leaders all over the world. Give them the wisdom, Lord God, and discernment to do what is right, not just for one, but for all. Father, I pray your continued blessings over this house of Zion called Prince of Peace. Bless us, Lord God, to be all that you have, that you would have us to be, moving forward, loving and caring for each other. Father God, I ask that you bless the shepherd of this house, the Reverend Dr. Jendayo Grady. Lord, his plate is always full. And as much as we try to give him some relief, Lord God, it's never enough. So, Father God, I pray that you continue to provide him with all that he needs to bring to fruition that which you have purposed him to do. Lord God, I pray blessings over the First Lady of this house, Sister Kelly Grady. Bless her, Father, with sound body and mind and the strength to do all that you have purposed her to do. Bless their children, young scholars, Lord God, that are growing up to be responsible young men and one young lady. Father God, I ask that you bless children that have not strayed from their roots, but are industrious in their pursuit to be all that you have purposed them to be. Father God, I pray blessings over children everywhere. Protect them, Lord God, from the evil that exists all around them. Bless them, Father, as they try to navigate this environment of uncertainty. Let your glory rain down upon them, Father, covering them, allowing children to just be children. And now, Father God, I pray blessings over the speaker of the hour, Reverend Sandra Glenn. Bring back to remembrance all that you have deposited within her. Let it come forth, Lord God, with clarity and conviction, touching the hearts of everyone under the sound of her voice, causing someone to come forth asking, what must I do to be saved? Father, I thank you for this time with you. a time, Lord God, set aside to worship, to learn, to bask in your presence. Father, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. In the precious name of Jesus the Christ, amen, amen, and amen.
I'll be committed to you. I'll never leave you. Nothing in this world could make me walk away. No matter what life may bring, I'll be by your side. No matter what you face, you won't be lonely. Because forever is a long time, and that's how long I'll love you. That's how
the Lord, saints. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. I'm here to lift up tithes and offerings. Tithes and offerings is a form of worship and allows us an opportunity to thank God and to praise God for the blessings that He has bestowed upon each and every one of us. In Malachi 3, God asks that we bring the full tithes into the storehouse, which is 10%. Now God wants us to put Him to the test. And He also will bless us beyond what we can think or imagine. Now in order to receive a blessing, there's a secret. The secret in receiving a blessing is that you will give with a loving and cheerful heart. Now, if you hold on to what you have, you won't receive anything. But with open hands, you'll receive what God has for you. So I thank those of you that have been faithful in your giving. And I personally want my cup to overflow with blessings. There'll be instructions on the screen telling you the three ways that you can give. I ask that you will enjoy this worship experience, that you'll be safe, that you'll let your light shine, that you'll have peace and joy, and may God bless you.
Let me hear you sing, bless, bless, bless. In the morning, in the noonday, in the nighttime, we're blessed, bless, 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 bless. We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. Sun's down with walk to right lay as a light in a dark land. Since thou was placed in thy heart, all the Lord's command. He set thee up of nation and got thy enemies away. He's standing up within thee, so let me hear you say. We're blessed in the city, we're blessed in the fields. We're blessed when we come and when we go. We cast down every stronghold, sickness and poverty must cease. For the devil.
Saints, I will be reading Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 to 32. Please read along with me. That same night he arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream and everything else that he had. And Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. And when the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. And then he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." But then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." And then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the people of Israel do not eat the sinew of the thigh that is on the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip on the sinew of the thigh. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Oh, the praises of our King. Rise among us, let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
Scripture has been read in your hearing, and I am delighted to be here today, and I want to give a shout out to our pastor. I want to give a shout out to this season that we're celebrating, the Lenten season, and of course we always celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and of course this month we're also celebrating the Women's History Month. And so today I'm going to be with you for a few minutes, and I'm really going to key in on those two verses in Genesis 32:26, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And 28, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven or wrestled with God and with men and have prevailed. And so our focus really is going to be on wrestling and striving between God and men. Amen. Amen. If you are like me, most of us tend to look at the things that are happening in the world, and many of us think that things are happening in record speed, and each generation seems to bring a contribution to the world. And I can remember the baby boomers, which is my generation, and one of the things we came out with was the afros, and even today we are still wearing the afros. And as I jump forward to today and look at our centennial generation, there are some things too that I'm so delighted that they have contributed to the world today. For an example, we know that this is the generation that kind of changed gospel music in a sense. They have incorporated hip-hop music into gospel music. They have incorporated rap into gospel music. And we can remember two Sundays ago when our youth blessed us tremendously when they sang that song, Glory. But one of the other things, too, that they have contributed to is this shortened way of texting. They are the digital generation. They've never lived without cell phones and so forth. And so they have come up with their own method and their own way of communicating with each other. And they are not wasting any letters. And we are all familiar with these words, BFF, best friend forever, or LOL, laughing out loud, or lots of love, or even the little old lady. And while some people might say that the reason they do that is to save time in texting, but there's another side of that that says they just don't want the older people to understand what they're saying. Now, I have to admit that there are some of those words I don't understand. But for me, that's not unusual, because even when I read the Bible, there are some things that I don't understand, and I have to check out someone else or look it up and so forth and so on. So my text for today, or my sermon text for today, is going to be something taken out of the Centennials booklet. And my sermon topic today is I-C-Y-M-I. And if you know what that means, you can write it in the chat. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for your love, and we thank you for your grace, and we thank you for your mercy. Come with us today, God, and do what only you can do as we prepare to give the word that you have given us, and let it not return void. And so I'm sure you know now that this topic of my sermon is, in case you missed it. Well, in case you missed it, this title really could pertain to every single book in the book of Genesis. And the reason for that is every single thing in the book of Genesis is breaking news. Every single thing could be something that is happening today when you look at all of the stories and so forth that happened during that time. And so today when I start to talk about Jacob and so forth, we will see that there are so many things that maybe we have missed. And so we're going to look today at some of the things that Jacob and Isaac and Esau did as we move along in this sermon. But let me give you a little background to the story before we get to the focus scripture. This story is about Jacob and Esau. Many people know who Jacob and Esau were, and most especially they're familiar with the name Jacob. Because anytime you talk about the patriarchs of the Bible, it is always Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You may also know that Esau and Jacob were twins. You may have heard that they battled even in the womb. And that when Jacob and Esau were born, Esau came out first, but Jacob was holding his heel. This is just one example of one of the dysfunctional families, because almost every family in the book of Genesis is considered dysfunctional. And so in this particular case, they are fraternal twins. And so they were kind of opposites of each other. Esau was the outside huntsman. Esau was the one who was favored by his father. And Esau was kind of, in my opinion, pompous and so forth. When we look at Jacob, Jacob was Rebekah, his mother's favorite, and Jacob was one who was an indoor person. And I think Jacob, if I could use my own words and use my own imagination, Jacob was the one who was a tent dweller, and he was intelligent, and I think he was shrewd, and I think he was kind of strategic, and he may have been a thinker. But the other thing about Esau being the oldest is that one of the most important things about the oldest person is that they will have a birthright, and they would inherit the status of being the patriarch of that family and the riches of the family, even though the other children would get something, but they would be the main person. So here we come to this story of Jacob and Esau. And as I mentioned to you, Esau is the one who likes to hunt. And so one day Esau was famished, and Esau came into the home and he said to Jacob, "I'm hungry. Can I have some of your stew?" And Jacob says, "Nope." He says, "Why? I'm hungry." And Jacob says, "Nope. Come on. Why can't I have some?" And Jacob probably said, "Well, you know, if you wanted some stew, you could have come home and fixed your stew." But the answer is no. Now, that's not unlike something that we would see within our families and so forth today. But after a while, Jacob, as I said, he's intelligent. Jacob said, "Okay." He said, "Tell you what, if you give me your birthright," he says, "I'll give you a bowl of stew." Now, Esau says, "Well, fine, because what good does it do me to have a birthright and I'm dead because I'm starving?" So this is what happened. Now, years have passed since this time. We don't know how many years. But the time came when Isaac, their father, was getting ready to die. And Isaac told Esau, "I want you to go out and I want you to hunt and bring me my favorite meal and come back, because I am going to pronounce my blessing on you." Now, what I did not say is he is blind. Isaac is blind. And so Esau goes out and he does this, and Rebekah overhears him, and Rebekah calls Jacob, and she tells Jacob what's going on, and she says, "Look, you have to get yourself together so you can go on and get this birthright." And so she helps him go in and try to trick the father, Isaac. And so as he goes in there, Isaac is blind, but, you know, he kind of suspects something. But nevertheless, Jacob convinces him that he's Esau. And so the blessing is placed upon Jacob. When Esau comes in and he finds out, he's absolutely furious. He is absolutely livid. And he declares out that when the father dies, he is going to kill Jacob. The mother tells Jacob, "Jacob, you've got to get out of Dodge. I want you to go over there where my brother lives, and you can live with him. And when things settle and everything, he says, you can come back. I want you to go with me on this." In case you missed it, when he leaves to go over there, he's already considered a trickster because that is his name, Jacob. And so when he gets over there to Laban, that's a whole other sermon that could come from that, because the Bible tells us Laban tricked Jacob. And so the time came when there was some friction between the two of them, and God told Jacob, go back home. God told Jacob to go back home. And as Jacob left in the middle of the night with his two wives, with his two maidservants, with all of the sheep and cows and all of these things that he had, he was heading back. Now, Jacob, though, is absolutely terrified because he has no idea whether or not Esau still wants to kill him. And this is where we move into what Jacob has to do and what God is calling Jacob to do. And so as Jacob moves forward, he gets to a point where he separates all of his camp, his people, into two different camps. And I told you, Jacob is strategic. And so what he does is he sends one camp out to see Esau, to tell him he's coming. He gives them all kinds of gifts. And he tells them to honor him and so forth. And so what Jacob finds out, though, is that Esau has 400 men coming to meet him. Now, I don't know about you, but if someone ever told me that Esau had 400 men coming to me, I know that I would be terrified. And I believe Jacob was terrified. So much so that the Bible tells us that Jacob went off by himself and he prayed that night. He left everybody and he went off and he prayed. And the Bible tells us the prayer that he prayed. He says, "Deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he come and attack me and the mother with the children. For you said, I will surely treat you well and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. Now, I believe if I could use my holy imagination, or Pastor Grady calls it divine imagination, and some people call it sanctified imagination from today, I believe Jacob would say, God, I need you now. Where are you? He's got 400 men. I'm doing what you told me to do. Please save my family so that we can serve you. We can't do anything without you. I am not smart enough, Lord. Please come and save us. God, you promised to treat me good and that I would have a lot of descendants." And I believe at this point that this is a time when Jacob's spirit is broken, that Jacob is at a time of repentance, because Jacob realized he's done something wrong. Now, there are two sides of the coin to that story, because remember, Esau sold and traded his birthright to Jacob. But nevertheless, he's gotten the rap because he stole the birthright. Now, you have to think on that. And so when we move on in the scripture, our focus verse, we go to verse 24. And Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. Verse 25, when the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Let me say that again. as he wrestled with him. So that's what we want to park on. But then he said, let me go, for the day has broken. He is an angel. And many people say that this is Jesus who was wrestling with him. But Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. Verse 28. And then he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and men and have prevailed. In case you missed it, this is the blessing that Jacob received. Verse 28, your name shall no longer be called Jacob. In other words, you're not going to be known as the trickster. He says you're going to be known as Israel, for you have striven with God. In other words, you have fought with God and you have struggled with God and men, and you have prevailed. So Jacob has become transformed. Now, again, in case you missed it, let's talk about what that word Israel means and what it portrays. Israel means struggle with God. Keep in mind, that is the name that God, the angel, gave to Jacob. One of the other things, in case you missed it, is if we think back to us and who we are today, we are heirs. We are heirs of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and therefore, we are a part of that nation of Israel. Therefore, we are expected to be able to struggle with God, because that name Israel ultimately became the name of that entire group of people. And even today, they are known as Israel, and there's even a nation over there, a country called Israel. So in case you missed it, God expects us to struggle. God expects us to wrestle with him. And he expects us to ask the tough questions. For many of us, we have grown up thinking that whatever's in the Bible is in the Bible, and that we should not even ask any questions. It is what it is. But I remind you to think back with Abraham when God wanted to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And you might know the story, but Abraham continued to go to God. But you're going to destroy them if 100 people are righteous? And God said, no. Are you going to destroy them if 50 people are righteous? And Abraham kept going until he got down to 5 people. And in the end, God didn't destroy them because Abraham had interceded and struggled with them. And so let's again move to Esau. Okay? Now, Esau probably is not unlike many people that we know today. There, I believe, are a lot of Esaus today. Esau may have made that promise to Jacob. We don't know whether or not he forgot what he had made, or did he just cavalierly make that thinking, which difference does it make? He's not going to get it anyway, you know, because that's my birthright. And I don't care. I just want some food. And so he was really not really appreciating what he had at the time. Now, there are some Esaus in our life, in your life. Who are the Esaus in your life? Who are the Esaus that we know today? What about someone promising to build a wall and requiring Mexico to pay for it? And when it doesn't happen, it's no big deal. Or about claiming that our health care plan, Obamacare, was so awful that a new one was needed, but another one was not developed or formulated. You see, we do know that there are some Esaus out there, and they really don't care what they say or how it is taken by anyone else. Also, in case you missed it, we also have a lot of Jacobs out there. And many of us might put ourselves in the category of an Esau or a Jacob, or we might know some people who have some Jacobs. Let's pause here and think about Jacob. Let's pause here and think about who Jacob is, since he is such a pivotal part to our story today. Not only that, Jacob is such a pivotal part of the entire Bible story. As I said before, it's always breaking news. As I said before, it is always front page news with what is going on today in the book of Genesis. With Jacob, Jacob was considered conniving. Jacob was considered cheating and maybe also taking advantage of people's weaknesses. So who are our modern Jacobs? I submit that maybe a lot of us are trying and struggling to do the right thing, but often falling short of the mark. But I'm so glad that even when we fall short of the mark, God is there with us. And we thank God that He is there with us. One of the other things I'm glad about is when we look at Malachi 3, that God said, Malachi 1, I'm sorry, verse 3, He says, Jacob I loved, and Esau I hated. I want to be on the side, I don't know about you, of God's love. What about you? Trying to do the right thing, even though it might turn out wrong. But God understands. When we look at this whole concept of wrestling, and as I mentioned before, most of the times we think that we should not be wrestling with God. But I think there are three things we need to understand about wrestling with God. Number one, why do we need to wrestle? Number two, how do we wrestle? And then number three, what are the benefits of wrestling? I'm so glad, too, at this particular time, we're in our Lenten season, because it is in this Lenten season that we begin to reflect, we begin to repent, we begin to fast, basically kind of wrestling with God with some things that we want to change or we want to really spend some time developing or formulating. So let's take a look at why do we need to wrestle. Number one, God may be asking us to do some things that we really don't want to do. So our job is to determine what God's mission is for us. What is the spiritual gift He's given us? Many people don't realize what that is. But that's one of the reasons why we need to wrestle with God. Another one, there may be some things you just don't understand, even in the scripture, but even in our personal life. God, why is this happening? God, how could this person do this to me? Take it to God. Wrestle with Him. Continue to stay with God with it. And we can get closer and more. We can get a closer and more intimate relationship with Him when we wrestle with Him. The next one is we grow when we wrestle. We have to ask the tough questions. Today, I am sure, all of us are asking this one tough question. And that question is this: God, why is Russia able to attack and kill the seemingly innocent people in Ukraine? What did they do to deserve this? I know all of us are asking this question, and we don't have an answer, but we know that God sees it. Or we might be asking God, what about my son? And what about my daughter? They're sick. Or what about my child who's strung out on drugs and I've done everything I can do? God, where are you? What should I do? God, help me. And these are the kinds of prayers that Jacob prayed when he went before God, when he went to wrestle with God. So how do we wrestle with God? Well, we're not, number one, going to have a physical person wrestling with God as Jacob did. Ours is going to be in the spiritual realm, okay? So we need to be honest with God. God can read our heart, but let's be honest with God. We should have a quiet space and time to spend with Him. And I know you're probably thinking, I don't have any other time. There's nothing else I can put on my calendar. But I believe that this is so important that we need to make time. And I think the benefits from this would be more than you could ever think or imagine. Then we have to be bold when we're wrestling with Him. Remember Jacob. Jacob says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So be bold in what we're asking Him. Then ask God for a blessing and ask Him to reveal Himself to you. Keep in mind that God will reveal Himself to you in different ways, but we cannot put God in a box. We can ask Him for a blessing, but don't put Him in a box. Expect to hear from Him. And then one of the things we can remember is this: God can come and speak to us in many different ways. God is on the throne, and we can wrestle with him. God can speak through the word. God can speak through another person. God can speak through a sermon, through a song, through that still, quiet voice, through a morning meditation, and the list goes on. Remember what I said, let's not put God in a box. But until we formulate and develop that personal relationship with him, we won't be able to discern the voice of God. And this is what we're talking about, how important it is to discern when God is speaking to us. And then the benefits of wrestling. I've already covered a lot of that. It helps us to develop our spiritual muscles. What does that mean? That means that when we get into a jam or when something happens to us, many times we are able to go to God and maybe we're able to pull up a scripture that's pertinent, that's going to cover us. For an example, if we remember the scripture, God, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And there are many scriptures that are out there that we are able to call on. And then we would develop a closer relationship with God, because God stretches us by engaging in dialogue with God and with others. What do I mean by that? Well, when we have a core group of people, or when we have friends that we can talk to, that we can discuss the Bible, it really helps in terms of developing us as Christians and developing us as servants of God. That's why I am so grateful that we have Bible study. Because when we go to Bible study, even though we have been in the Word for years and years and years, each time we go into Bible study, there is another way that it is broken down so that we understand it much better. So let me tell you a secret. One of the characters in the Bible, a very, very well-known character in the Bible, is just not my favorite character in the Bible. And that's Paul, because Paul says certain things about women and so forth. But in Bible study, we kind of did a study on some of the things of Paul. And it really did change my whole view and understanding of who Paul was and who Paul is. And so I say to you, all of us can grow. All of us can learn. And so I do encourage you and invite you to come to Bible study, to learn and to be a better servant of God. So now, as I prepare to take my seat, one of the things we have to remember is God wants us to wrestle with him. God named his people Israel. That means we are going to struggle. God doesn't want us to be robots or automatons. He wants us to ask the questions, because when we ask the questions, we can learn more. But the most important thing of all that God wants us to understand is the price that was paid. So all of that wrestling Jacob did with a human, we're not going to wrestle like that, because God has always paid that price on that cross for us. And all we have to do is confess with our mouths, believe in our hearts that Jesus died on that cross. And so that every single thing, every single problem we have, God can tell you, I've got it. God can tell you, I see you. I pray, oh God, that everybody would learn and know who Jesus is. That you would be blessed to know that God is your family. God is your Lord, and he's always there with you. And so as I open the doors of the church today, is there someone who does not know who Jesus is in the pardoning of his sin, of their sins? Is there someone who wants to have a closer walk with God? Is there someone who says, I don't know how to hear the word of God? I have not learned how to discern his voice. Let me tell you, it is possible to do it. Come with us to Bible study, or either just seek God on your own behalf. If you don't know what it means to say that you've been healed by God, just listen. God can heal you. And so if you want to come to know God and know Jesus, put it in the chat and someone will be in touch with you. If you want prayer, put it in the chat. Someone will be in touch with you. This is Prince of Peace Community Church and Healing Center. We love you. We praise God for you. And we are so thankful that you decided to worship with us today, because God is a good God and he's worthy to be praised. And I want to know, how many of you are ready to wrestle with God and go deeper in an understanding of who this great God is about us? Amen, amen, and amen.
At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. 'Cause at the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. Jesus, you are Lord. From their eyes, once blinded eyes will see that you are Lord. Yes, you are.